There's not one right.
Sandra, but think of me as your personal Dante, guiding you through the southeast corner of Kansas.
At the beginning of the 20th century, the coal mines that gave jobs to thousands of Italian immigrants often became devastating infernos. The hardship of immigrant life often seemed a challenge in purgatory. But for many Italians, Southeast Kansas became and still is a rewarding paradise. In this building near the corner of 4th and Broadway, downtown Pittsburgh, Italian editor Eduardo Caffaro provided the only Italian newspaper of the region for 23 years, between 1905 and 1928. Caffaro's newspaper, called Il Lavoratore Italiano, chronicled the lives of the Italians in Southeast Kansas. The newspaper witnessed the events of the time, which helped to shape the Italian community into what it is today. Caffaro Spirit will join me in telling you this fascinating story.
Not too far from the mythical towns of the Wild West and the adventures of Wyatt Earp, Crawford and Cherokee counties in the extreme southeast corner of Kansas witnessed a less glorified history. Nevertheless, this region provides an intense story of mining activities that attracted hundreds of thousands at the turn of the 20th century. Pittsburgh owes its importance to banker and lawyer Franklin Plater. In 1876, he managed to convince the railroad companies to lay tracks in the area and allow the commercialization of the coal. The exploitation of the coal field changed the original agricultural economy and created an unprecedented population growth. In the late 1900s, Pittsburgh was the fourth largest city in Kansas, and the coal industries attracted large numbers of Americans and new immigrants from Eastern and Southern Europe. As a result of the coal-based economy, other small towns mushroomed both in Crawford, Cherokee, and neighboring counties. Frontenac, founded in 1886, Arma in 1909, Chicopee, Franklin, Scammon, Mulberry, Crawburg, and other small villages originally built as companies' mine camps. European immigrants accounted for half of the mine workers during the most productive period between 1900 and 1920. They flocked from Slovenia, Austria, France, Germany, Italy, Belgium. Others were Poles, Hungarians, Welsh, Irish, Scots.
Beginning in the 1870s and 80s, began to get a shift in immigration from those areas in northern and western Europe to central and eastern Europe.
The open immigration policy and constant recruiting by the mining companies brought entire villages and families to the region.
Many of the people were recruited to come. There was a sense by the railroads or in areas like Kansas to get people to settle unoccupied land to bring them here.
Although contracting was prohibited, many came from the old continent, lured by companies and countrymen who had already found a job in the mines.
The coal companies in this area were especially
in the Pittsburgh area, the Colorado area, and the Pennsylvania area were sending miners, representatives over to Italy, France, and Germany looking for workers.
Many of the miners came over with experience in mining. However, there were large numbers, or at least some people, came over without any experience in mining.
The 1915 census of the Kansas Board of Agriculture recorded the significant presence of new immigrants in the two counties. Ethnic diversity gave a special flavor to the region. It became somehow or other what is still known as the Little Balkans of Kansas. European-born miners increased the power of unions and enlarged socialist groups, which fought against big corporations, unsafe working conditions, and underpaid jobs.
This was a unionized coal field, and I have to say that there were some very controversial and angry confrontations between the miners and the management or owners.
The mining industry also created a complex economy and the necessity for food and living supplies, a banking system, and an entertainment industry with bars, dancing, and sports halls. For the ethnic minorities, this meant their own stores, crops, and diversions. Some of them later became emblems of Southeast Kansas. Socialism was very strong in Southeast Kansas. J.A. Whalen's Appeal to Reason, a widely circulated socialist newspaper, was published in Girard, a few miles north of Pittsburgh. The socialist and the ethnic press were also important communication means for discriminated minorities.
There was discrimination, of course, again, because the new kid on the block is always tested. You are wrongly assumed to be stealing their jobs, or will at some point. Or you're new, you're different. You don't drink what they drink, you drink wine. Well, beer and whiskey is better.
I went to school, I'd pronounce D's and O's, Cree, and my teacher, I recall, made me get up in front of the class to break me when she said, you get up in front of the class when you say these, you stick your tongue out, these, those, because I couldn't bring my tongue forward to pronounce the THs. And I recall that, I thought that was a little embarrassing.
Slowly, American optimism about greeting immigrants began to fade. And so rather than saying that everyone who came here would help build a larger country, now they were thinking of it as American resources were finite, so that if we think of it, everyone getting a piece of the pie, the piece of the pie was shrinking and getting smaller and smaller.
Il lavoratore italiano, the Italian worker, tried to ease the relationship between Italians and the mainstream for 23 years. Next, we'll see how immigrant men and women, like the Italians, heavily contributed to the economy, the culture, and the society as we know it today. In other words, how they changed forever the history of Southeast Kansas.
History is such a transient notion, hard to catch. It's made of memories, places, and stories told by those who lived it. It's made of sights. And here at Mount Carmel in Frontenac, among these white Italian marble graves, we find its signs.
When the hero of Italian unification, Giuseppe Garibaldi, left Italy to fight more battles in South America, the newborn modern nation was facing economic hardship, like several other European countries. the Italian government encouraged emigration as a way to deal with the unstable economy.
The turn of the century, 85% of immigrants were coming from South Central and Eastern Europe and Mediterranean Europe. And this brought large numbers of people from the Austro-Hungarian Empire, from Russian Empire, from Italy, from Greece, from the islands in the Mediterranean.
Between the 1880s and the First World War, an estimated 5 million Italians immigrated to the Americas. That counted for a third of the entire population. Most of these immigrants were male, unskilled workers.
Migration from what we call Italy today was from northern Italy. And most of these were skilled artisans in the building trades, as well as some factory workers, who in the 1840s and 50s and 60s began to migrate elsewhere in Europe.
Artisans and tradesmen from northern Italy began coming to the United States in the 1880s and 1890s.
At the turn of the century, we began to get a large immigration from Naples and Sicily. And these tended to be from smaller villages. They did not have artisan skills. They worked in the construction industry. They were heavily recruited and came in large groups.
The majority of immigrants came from the poorest rural regions of South Italy and settled in big metropolises, often experiencing traumatic changes. Many came with the idea of making enough money to go back to Italy wealthy.
There was difference in the migration as well. Less women came in the new immigration. Also in part for some of the people, especially from the Mediterranean, they came, they thought temporarily.
53.8% of southern Italians, 50.2% of central Italians, and 40% of northern Italians come back or repatriate from the United States.
Kansas was no exception in this trend. The majority of Italians who settled in Kansas City were Sicilians. But the majority of Italians who settled in this mining area came from the northern and central regions of the peninsula.
When you have no language, you don't know the language of the environment that you come to, then you have to take any job you can get, one that does not require communication.
Great cultural and social differences divided these Italians, who looked at each other with suspicion and identified with their region more than with the Italian nation.
Venice, Florence, the next one, Genoa, Pisa. See, all these were powerful little nations, and the papal states, and they had to want to unite. And who wants to give up their priorities and their standing in their own eyes or in history and their powers.
We think of Italians today as one group, but Northern Italians very much saw themselves as Europeans, very much saw themselves as part of a rich heritage in Europe, whereas Sicilians saw themselves very much as Mediterranean people with a rich heritage, but an entirely different heritage.
Some of the Italians around here call themselves the Tirolesi. And one time they're Austrian, another time they're Italian.
For 48 years, these Italian papers have been publishing about coming and freeing us, the Tyroleans, from the slavery of potatoes. Now it is time to change the name of Italy to the United States of Tyrol.
Although many Italian immigrants eventually went back to Italy, these birds of passage soon began to nest and brought their wives and families over to the new country.
It was common for the men to come over and work for an indefinite period and save as much money as they could for the passage of their wives or brides-to-be and children. This was common, is that the Italian and Austrian and Slovene miners would come over and sometimes work for years. And then at a later time, they would bring their families over.
In 1918, he wrote back to his to Luisa Castagna, which was her name, and asked if she'd come over and marry him. They were kind of sweethearts in school. It took her 2 weeks from when she left Genoa Italy to land in New York. And in 2 days, she went through Ellis Island, where they processed them. And as she said, they were just processed just like cattle would. There were so many of them there at one time. And none of them could speak English, so they had a tag around her neck, which showed what their destination was. She landed here in Pittsburgh. My dad met her there at the train station. They went the next day to Girard and got married. And that was the start of our family.
Mine camps, predominantly male-populated, started changing after the arrival of women and children. Barren family houses, stores, and churches replaced old barracks. Some camps disappeared, others became small villages. The Italians in southeast Kansas, despite strong regional differences, tried to recreate a general Italian culture and way of life in the arduous and unfamiliar place.
Circumstances also made it necessary that they all unite and pull together, because otherwise, you know, united we stand, divided we fall. They learned that quickly.
There were all kinds of entertainments. For example, the Italians watched some of the small operas in Frontenac, and the language of the operas was in Italian. The men boxed, the men ran races. We know about the Italians bringing in the game of boccia.
Everybody planted a garden, just as we of Italian origin still do to this day.
In this part of the cemetery, many Italian children are buried. They were victims of poor living conditions and the Spanish flu, which killed millions in the U.S. between 1918 and 1921, especially elderly and the very young.
Italians came to southeast Kansas also thanks to the ethnic network that existed among the immigrant miners of the Midwest, often attracted by promises of false financial improvements.
After the pine hunter, he said they weren't, the wages were about the same. He said there was very little difference, except the mines weren't as deep here as they were in Colorado, and I think they kind of liked that a little bit. But outside of that, they were basically the same thing.
The Italian ethnic press was the only mass medium available to Italian miners.
It wasn't just a question of literacy. You could go to some bars and cafes, and during times of the day, someone would read the newspaper for those people who are illiterate. So we can't think in the 21st century notion that the number of subscribers are the people who knew the paper, and that illiterate people were cut off from this world. They weren't.
They needed information on jobs as well as Italian and local news. In this region, their newspaper was called the Italian Worker. In Italian, Il Lavoratore Italiano.
He was kind of a voice for them, as newspapers can be.
Il Lavoratore Italiano was the voice of some 20,000 Italian workers living in the rural Midwest.
It was a much larger network, and so that those Italian newspapers, which would go to other communities as well, allow the kind of contact and networking that these workers would have been isolated otherwise.
Born near Turin in 1878, Eduardo Cafaro left his native Alps in Piedmont at the turn of the century. The publication started in 1905, when Mr. Eduardo Cafaro came to Pittsburgh from Trinidad, another mining area in southeast Colorado, where the newspaper had originally started in 1901. He was an educated engineer, socially and politically involved with the Socialist Party and unions, as were many others at the time.
Cafaro was a very intelligent man. He enjoyed talking with my grandfather, who'd been also of account and Italian cavalry officer and colonel in the Italian cavalry, and was an educated man because he'd gone to university.
The newspaper was part of a tradition of politically engaged Italian-American publications. The adjective Italian appealed to a general audience made up of men, women, families, and advertisers. Cafaro keenly observed and recorded the transformation of the Kansas Italian community over the years.
Kafka would play it up in his paper as to what the Italians needed or what they should be doing in order to attain this goal or whatever it was that their aspirations were.
Dr. Collelmo has been elected president of the Medical Association of Crawford County. He is the first Italian doctor in the United States to reach such a high and honorable position.
Above all, it tried to give voice to a discriminated minority.
There was a wrong committed by a black man. Such and such, parentheses, Negro, such and such, done by an Italian. Let's say he was speeding or whatever it was, parentheses, Italian. Not for anyone else, never for any other ethnicity or race.
By the end of the 1920s, many had left the counties, and second-generation Italians raised in American schools were more fluent in English than Italian. The war, the Red Scare, and the Depression had virtually killed the Socialist Party and unions. That's when Cafaro pulled up stakes and sold the printing plant.
Today, the Crawford County Historical Museum pays tribute to coal mining, which was at the time the single most important industry in the area. With shovel like this, the mining and smelting industries thrived in southeast Kansas.
The vastly agricultural economy of southeast Kansas drastically changed in the late 1800s. Mine camps appeared as a result of the exploitation of the coal field that ran across this region.
There were a lot of little tiny mines that they called dinkies. And dinkies were just holes in the side of a canyon, or excuse me, a gully, an outcropping, and one or two or three people would mine the coal. The big shaft mines were established in the late 1800s, and in the 1890s and the early 1900s. Some of the camps were small. Maybe the population of the smallest ones were around 100 people, and there were some that had a few thousand people.
Near Highway 69, south of Pittsburgh, was mine number 5 of the Santa Fe Company. The mining camp grew into the small town of Chicopee. The west part of the camp was called Little Italy, with thriving Italian stores and Scotty Scedamucci's tavern. Today, the tailing piles excavated from mine number 5 are still visible as a mount covered by vegetation.
The company would collect and build these little shacks. They could be square, they could be rather long, and the squarish ones were called the hip roof shacks or cabins, and the longer ones were called the cracker box.
This bed and breakfast right outside Pittsburgh used to be an old miner's house. Several houses like this have been remodeled in this area. Unfortunately, miners didn't enjoy such beautiful furniture or modern time appliances.
Underground mining was a dangerous job. Workers sank a shaft in the ground about 100 to 200 feet deep. An elevator that the miners called a cage brought the workers to the entrance of the mine. Usually, the entries were about 7 feet high and allowed blind mules to carry the coal dug by miners.
They say a mule isn't dumb, but they are smart. They hated to get in that elevator to go down that shaft. You could just see they had to actually push them to get in. When they got ready, they'd take 3 down at a time. When they got ready to put that mule in there, he didn't want to go. So I said, that mule don't want to go. I don't want to go either.
They worked in tunnels, little galleries that you follow the vein of coal about that deep on their knees. And they filled up those little coal cars, which possibly were 1/4 ton each
The miners would tell me that they worked on their knees so much that they would wear blisters on their knees, and the wives would have to bleed the blisters every night.
Rescue teams were trained in Pittsburgh, but casualties and injuries occurred on a regular basis.
The mines around here were dangerous. There were cave-ins in which people were killed and injured. They were very unhealthy because the ventilation was not good, and the coal, when it's broken, releases sulfur. So they were not only breathing carbon, but they were breathing sulfur and other chemicals or gases.
We boys wanted to know what a coal mine was like. He said, no, he said, he'd been there. He went to his tomb every day. He said, I will tell you all about it, but you will not have to go down in a dangerous thing.
Other companies were reluctant. They didn't want the extra expense, and they resisted making the mines safer and cleaner until the striking miners forced them, or until courts forced them to make the mines cleaner and less dangerous.
The precariousness of the job and its dangers were the unions and Il Laboratorio Italiano's concerns. Southeast Kansas belonged to the 14th District of the United Mine Workers, whose president, Alexander Howitt, an immigrant from Scotland, had become a powerful and controversial leader.
The object of the union is to improve the intellectual and moral conditions, to receive better compensation, to use every means of obtaining peace among ourselves and our employer, resorting to a strike only when all peaceful means of adjusting differences have failed.
The Italian newspaper echoed the unions.
Strikers in the copper district only ask $3 per day, 8-hour working day, and the right to speak through the union. A way too humble and reasonable request. One Italian miner died. Reports say accidental death. I say it is the company's fault. How can a 50-ton rock go unobserved by the fireballs?
Because the mining industry was so important, the union became this mammoth institution. And for many workers in Southeast Kansas, the hierarchy in the union was just another enemy to fight. And Alex Howitt was this grassroots local leader, and on several occasions he confronted John Lewis, who was the president of the United Miners Union. Howitt and many European workers felt that Lewis was selling out the miners, and he bought too easily to the companies, and editor Edward Caffaro was with them.
Over and over, Il Lavoratore sternly supported Howitt's militant agenda and his struggles against the mining companies and the leadership of the union. In the later years of publication, however, the loss of power of the unions and the sharp decrease of the mining labor force in the area had an impact on Il Lavoratore's militantism. By the late 20s, the mining industry had changed the mining technique, going from shaft mining to strip mining.
Machines with a few men could mine more coal than a large army of underground miners working with crude implements and mules and carts and similar ways of underground mining. At first, strip mining was a little bit clumsy and primitive, but through the years, the shovels became bigger, they could go deeper, and they were more efficient. So it was just technology finally doing in the shaft mining.
This guy, Big Brutus, is the biggest shovel for strip mining. He replaced the men and the mules needed for shaft mining.
By the early 30s, many Italian miners had moved, either to other places or up on the social ladder. Strip mining disrupted the ecological system. Today, red johns, as the miners called the acidic water of the creeks, are still visible.
His Majesty Big Brutus retired after the last mine was closed in the early 90s. He became the main attraction of a museum situated a few miles west of Pittsburgh. In 1969, the state of Kansas passed a conservation act requiring reclamation of most mined land.
Immigrant miners infused new life into this region, often endangering and even losing their own. They boosted the economy, created opportunities, and founded banks. In other words, they shaped a different community. The contribution that these miners made to this area still lives on today.
The Palooka store has been in Frontenac for three generations. Owner Richard Palooka continues the family tradition in the food business.
Grandfather Palooka came over here in 1904. He wound up in Frontenac because there was other people here from San Pellegrino, Italy. He started a grocery store, an Italian cooperative grocery store on Cherokee Street. And they were there from 1909 till 1930. Then they moved uptown to Frontenac. Grandfather went on with his two sons, Raymond and Joe, and ran the store. I took over the whole store in about 1988, I think, or 89. And we've been here ever since, been here since 1909, and we continue on with the Italian tradition of imported foods.
In southeast Kansas, home life improved dramatically with the arrival of women and children. However, mining towns remained drab and modest. At the same time, richer mainstream America was prey to the Red Scare and blamed new immigrants for the nation's turmoil.
Now it is a belief that immigrants are bringing these foreign ideas to the United States, and therefore a way of preventing unionization and socialism would be to restrict immigration.
With the increase of restrictions during and right after World War I, fewer and fewer Italians immigrated to the United States.
The 1921 Immigration Act, which became permanent in 1924, restricted immigration to the United States, and it restricted it based on, it established quotas based on the 1890 census, which was, after all, believed to be before the new immigration started. So it was not just a restriction on immigration, but to say that the old immigration was desirable and the new immigration was not.
In the mid-20s, miners' numbers plummeted as the smelting industry moved west and many Italians went back to the homeland. These changes appear in the evolution of Il Lavoratore Italiano. The newspaper originally targeted a male audience. With the years, it adjusted, trying to maintain a shrinking readership, diversifying contents to appeal to women and young adults.
I marvel at it how instinctively, the minute I stepped into the door, I was an Italian boy. Outside, I was an American. I spoke English.
As second-generation Italian children grew up American, Il Lavoratore increased the use of the English language. The influence of the American mainstream press was visible in the newspaper in other ways.
The over 10,000 subscribers of Il Lavoratore lived in several states in the Midwest. Sales agents traveled from Kansas to Missouri, Illinois, Colorado, and other places to sell the newspaper. Most of the revenue, however, came from advertisers. Ads, in fact, counted for over a third of each issue. Caffaro made changes that reveal the importance of the economic factors as well as the historical ones in the survival of the newspaper.
Both ethnic and non-ethnic advertisers found it profitable to target the Italian readership of Il Lavoratore. As many socialists, Caffaro was a pacifist. Il Lavoratore condemned the Italian colonialist war in Africa and the conflict in the Balkans. wars exemplified the foolishness of the capitalist world, both in the old and the new country.
Races, nationalities, all this is just a shiny polish that hides the horrible skeleton of reality. Every war is a war of the social classes. The war factor is, in essence, only one: economics.
The year 1911 has ended in bloodshed. Trains, ships, and the telegraph have shortened distances. We will be able, with a wonderful rapidity, to find out when our children and brothers were slaughtered in war.
You still had this ethnic turmoil in the United States, where the people were divided, and so the 1917 Espionage Act, which was renewed in 1918, had for only the second time in the United States a Sedition Act to suppress those people exercising their constitutional right to oppose the war.
However, the necessity to maintain a voice in the Italian community and to survive hard times made Cafaro tone down his political activism during World War I.
As soon as the U.S. entered the war, the American government created the Committee for Public Information to spread war propaganda and to silence opposition to the war. The CPI suggested self-censorship to the press, but the government censorship was regularly implemented by the Postal Service. All publications in languages other than English were required to file in translations for all articles to the postmasters. The postmasters then decided whether these articles were appropriate or not. In the case they weren't, it could take away the second-class mailing privileges, and this made it impossible for ethnic publications to survive.
This explains why, starting in 1917, Cafaro stopped publishing anti-war articles, filling the pages with less dangerous romance novels and even pro-war rhetoric. Stout socialists and unionists reprehended this sudden support to the war. When censorship was lifted in the war aftermath, Cafaro resumed his political activism in the form of anti-fascism.
Congressman Mussolini, whose big ego is inflated just by listening to himself, preaches that tranquility is all over Italy. This tranquility is nothing else than the terror that everyone is forced to live with.
Ironically, the ethnic press helped Italians to become American and created the basis for its own decline. Cafaro published less and less regularly in the 20s, also because of his bad heart condition. The Depression, migrations, and acculturation of Italians caused the newspaper's final stroke.
When Il Lavoratore Italiano was sold to an American editor in 1928, it became apparent that a new social balance existed. The Italian resistance to a discriminatory Anglo-Saxon mainstream and the historical necessity to adapt had ended its cycle. For many, Americanization meant conformity. For others, especially women, it meant struggling for an active position in the private and in the social spheres.
'13 was an important year for American women. Debates on suffrage, equality, and feminism abounded also in this part of the country.
Cafaro left us with a comprehensive depiction of women and their issues in the pages of the Italian Worker.
In Southeast Kansas, women issues were widely discussed in the mass media, and suffrage and temperance were two important issues at the time. Women of the caliber of Susan B. Anthony were important to Kansas politics, and actually she participated in the writing of the state constitution. In Southeast Kansas, moderate positions of the progressive era were widely accepted, like, for example, the idea of the right to vote for women. But more radical positions were hard to accept. Very few people went to see Emma Goldman's in Pittsburgh in 1900,
And Wieland, who was the socialist editor of the Appeal to Reason, was certainly not one of them.
Cofferow stood for the progressive positions of socialism and reflected the feminist debates.
In what name and principles do we expect the law to consecrate the masculine prominence if nature itself has given equal rights and duties to man and woman? In times of freedom and socialism, she has to take action, not through her charm, but through the rights that the law must recognize.
Contrasting visions of women coexisted within the Socialist Party. Also, unions were entirely male-centered and left little space for women in the public sphere, with some famous exceptions.
As I was reading about this women's protest movement in this poem, my grandmother stopped and she was cooking some Italian spaghetti and she said, well, you know, I was in that protest march myself. She said they all the women sort of gathered at a Franklin community hall or a church. It was very cold, but she said all we had, a lot of us had, were not very warm coats at that time. She was wearing a sweater. She remembered she was very cold. And she grabbed her son at the time, her oldest son, and they went to the Dunkirk mine. They walked to the Dunkirk mine, which it was about 3/4 of a mile, and she remembers at that time there might have been 200 other women coming, and it was just an amazing amount of women and children.
In December 1921, several Italian women marched on the front line of what the mainstream press called the Amazon Army.
Whereas our husbands are striking against a law to enslave our children, which is known as the Allen Industrial Slavery Law, we, the wives of the loyal men of Kansas, feel that it is our duty to stand shoulder to shoulder with our husbands in this struggle.
So by the next day, 2,000 to 3,000 women were reported to have been a part of this great marching group.
Holding their children in their arms, women of Southeast Kansas left their homes. They were resolved to stop strikebreakers from entering the mines because that would make their men's 6-month-long strike for better working conditions a lost cause. Alarmed by the resilience of these women, Governor Allen of Kansas brought 4 battalions of armed men to Pittsburgh. Allen was supported by the mainstream press, but ridiculed by Il Lavoratore Italiano.
The miners' wives have spontaneously intervened in the struggle. Every morning they march, 3,000, 4,000 of them. And now the militia is here to protect Lewis' men from Howard's women and children.
Even though the marching women only carried American flags and lunchboxes with red pepper as their weapons, the militia felt threatened and started to shoot and to arrest them.
And my grandmother said at that point, while she was walking away, she felt gunshots at her feet.
The arrested women are no cowards. Instead of praying to God and all saints, they are singing loud and clear. They don't sing out of key, but from behind key.
At that time, most people who were arrested had to post a $200 bond. These women had to post a $750 bond.
The women marched right along with the men. I know my cousin Ori, she lived in the north part of the town, and we went up there one time, and Ori wasn't home. We said, where is she? And they said, she's marching. And the women and the men marched. They marched up there. They marched.
From his prison cell, Alexander Howitt called the march off. Although capable of getting national attention to help their families reach freedom, this bunch of alien women had to continue their struggle from within their home. In fact, these appearances in the social sphere didn't change the reality of a deeply rooted patriarchal society. Once in the new country, Italian women still play traditional gender roles revolving around the private sphere.
Sometimes I'd have to stand on a chair to reach the cook stove because I was too little. And then when I had to wash the dishes, the boys would make me wash dishes and they'd put put the dishpan full of dishes on a chair, and I'd stand there on the floor and wash them dishes.
Women of the northern regions tended to be more independent than the southerners because of ancient cultural differences.
The Etruscans were the ones who gave the first equality to women. And remember, when did we get our civil rights equality for women? We used to fight as unionists, and I'm a unionist, equal pay for equal work, equal rights and all. Well, they did that in 1700 BC.
However, patriarchy was still the norm for Italians in the new country.
A more traditional family role perhaps the ideal in the Italian family would be that the woman would take care of all the domestic chores, which ironically included chores for earning money, that is, tending a small kitchen garden. And they might sell chickens, they might sell some of the produce. They might do some sewing and millinery work. So all of this, but it took place in the family. The Italian family is more likely to send the children out to work first, especially if it was outside of the household. And then if women earned money, as they did in Italy, the idea was to find some work that was consistent with them staying within the home rather than going outside the house for wage labor.
The dusty angels of the household, women, also brought back to the mine camps the sense of religion that most husbands had repudiated in the name of socialism.
They were strong women. They were determined women. They understood what they were getting into. They were the religious ones in a family. But instead of, you can't criticize the men for not going to church on Sundays. If you work 6 days a week, your seventh day, you can hardly drag your weary body to church.
There was tremendous resistance against the clergy and the institutional church, but within the Catholic identity, people remained in the church rather than just opposing it.
Il Lavoratore prospered, addressing an increasingly important female audience in a very practical way.
The men were pretty much out of the picture for the most part. From what my grandmother said, you know, they woke up at 4 o'clock in the morning and they didn't go to bed till 9 or 10 at night, and that day was filled with all the duties that they had to manage in the house, including managing the money.
Women, even more than men, were crucial both in improving social status for the immigrants and to the perpetuation of Italian values and traditions.
The tradition of Italian editors continued in southeast Kansas after Il Lavoratore Italiano was shut down. In 1934, Italian-American editor Charles Cicero started another weekly newspaper called the Frontenac Press.
On Mondays and Tuesdays, we went to Pittsburgh to solicit advertising, half a day. The other half a day, we'd come back and start doing work in the shop. And we printed our paper. Thursday night, sometime we worked till midnight to get it out, and we had four or five local boys delivering the paper around town on Friday morning. I didn't have the knowledge, actually, because I didn't have no journalism. I had printing. So I had three newspaper writers from the Pittsburgh Sun. I bought an automatic newspaper press where I could print two pages at a time. Before, we could only print one page at a time. We had a good circulation of people living away from here, from California to New York.
The Frontenac Press targeted a non-ethnic readership, using English as the common language of this multicultural community. With World War II, the Frontenac Press was discontinued, and a sense of uniqueness disappeared with it. The early 30s brought several other changes in the Italian-American community in southeast Kansas. Economic depression and the decrease of available jobs forced several people to make do in legal but often illegal ways.
The large number of Italians involved in bootlegging needs to be understood in their culture, which doesn't stigmatize social alcohol consumption and praises moderate drinking habits.
When one thinks of Kansas, still today thinks dry, but the Balkans, well, the Balkans were very different. It's ironic how Kansas was to the forefront of prohibition at one time, and Southeast Kansas was at the forefront of bootlegging, providing alcohol basically for the national market. And everybody was doing it, a lot of Italians too, because bootlegging was just a way to make do in this depressed economy during the 20s. The mines were closing, and deep shaft actually became a euphemism for the booze, which was often hidden underground. Very few people became rich, but for the majority, this was just a matter of survival, especially for Italians, because they were not fully accepted by the mainstream at the time. Now, you imagine that bootleggers looked like the mobsters in the movies. Quite on the contrary, they were quite regular people. Often women were directly involved, because somehow making booze was part of their domestic role anyway. Certainly some bad things happened, but the overwhelming majority didn't have skeletons in their closet, just stills and barrels, that's for sure.
As it had happened during the First World War, alien and sedition laws made the home front of World War II a dangerous ground. Italian Americans, German Americans, and even more Japanese Americans became victims of prejudice. Giving up their ethnic identity often became the only way to survive the war.
We were told that we had to get ahead in order that we could enjoy America too.
Italian Americans showed their loyalty to the United States cause for liberty, becoming the largest ethnic group fighting in Europe during World War II. But that wasn't enough. Between 1941 and the end of the conflict, thousands of Italians and Italian Americans were forced to live under curfew and leave their homes. Some hundreds of Italian men were taken to Fort Missoula in Montana or imprisoned in other camps in Oklahoma, Texas, Tennessee, and California.
Civil rights battles in the last 30 years have changed America and opened the doors for debates on racial and ethnic discrimination in unprecedented terms. Only in recent years has America started to look into ethnic groups beyond trite stereotypes and generalizations. Ethnic groups reflect American society's diversity and microcosms.
It's not easy to maintain dual cultures. It's not easy to live in both cultures, especially when the largest society at various times will shift from respecting that separate culture to in fact denigrating that culture.
America deals today with multiculturalism. If racism and discrimination still mar this country, ethnic heritage, purged from negativity, becomes a proud assertion of identity.
So now I think we're able to look back at what this particular culture has given to the world, and people admire it.
I hear them talk about their ethnic past. They talk about grandmother and grandfather coming over from Italy or from Austria or Slovenia, so they take pride in that.
In Southeast Kansas, the term Little Balkans is one of pride today as it was of shame when it was first coined. The same mainstream society that ignored and discriminated against minorities now celebrates them every year. The Women's March, like other almost forgotten stories, is now regaining its historical significance through new research and is being made accessible to the public.
And it still is, I think, happening in communities like Frontenac today, where education becomes the way to a better life, and that you will give your last dime to the school or whatever the school needs, you're going to do, because you believe that that is a way for a better life for your family.
They're really accepted now as the prime, just as much as the English were. Those days, the English were the only ones that were really accepted. the Germans and Italian and French were kind of looked down at.
The Italian language slowly disappeared with many other marks of ethnicity while Italians reached high positions in society. Josiah still remains one of the prominent politicians in Crawford County. Along with him, professors, journalists, lawyers, and businessmen. In this corner of Kansas, the fast food signs are bigger than that of a little Italian grocery store. Looking more deeply, though, one can find other signs. Those of men and women who came from Italy and other places, and whose stories create yet another perspective in what we call American history.
Hopefully, everybody is sort of embracing the fact that we can be diverse and individual and different and still be okay.
Here in Kansas, people look down at our corner of the state and they say, oh, that they're the Balkan people, you know, they're different. They've had a history of coal mining and strikes, and they like to argue, and they like to do this and that, and they're very independent and proud. We are independent and proud. Even those of us who were not born in this area, when we come to this area, we sometimes become Balkan, and we like our Italian neighbors or Austrian neighbors. So it's been an interesting experience living in this part of Kansas. I've thoroughly enjoyed the ethnic groups.
Today, little remains of Il Laboratorio Italiano and its editor, Eduardo Caffaro. Just a few microfilm reels and a picture in a book. Its legacy, though, lives on and has only started to be recognized. Here's what Italian miner Giacomo Bartello had to say about the significance of the Kansan Italian newspaper.
The story of Il Laboratorio Italiano is the story of honest miners. Honor to this humble newspaper that, with little money, helped the emancipation of the weak.
And here we are in this typical Italian vegetable garden, and at the end of our story about the paesani who made a little known part of Kansas history. With their contribution, this region prospered and witnessed impressive struggles for modern democracy. This is their version of the American dream.
Ipocrisia, di profondità in un abisso.